So nobody has replied, so all of you have got understood. Just for your benefit, I just would like to revise how your answer flow should be as far as this OTN is concerned. So initially, you are beginning with this definition and with its brief explanation, like it is a set of facilities provided by the interconnections of the optical fibers to cater for the transmission of data between different network elements. So the different functionalities it has supported or supporting are like switching, routing of data, like that. So then the main point you have to, after the definition you have to quote here, is that should tell that it is a successor of SDH or SONET along with the DWDM. Then you can go for explaining the four-layer structure of this OTN according to IT/UT G.709 recommendation. So then this what the key point you told, that it is successor of SDS or SONET and DWDM. So these two technologies have got issues, but if you look at this WDM transmission layered structure, SDH and this DWDM or optical layer are used as the backbone for the construction of this OTN. OTN is going to resolve the issues of the SDH and WDM. So what are the issues the SDH and WDM have got, and why you gone for DWDM? How OTN has resolved the DWDM issues, and how it has been using these two, SDH and optical layer, as the pillars to provide multi-service protocol implementation like SDH, SONET, or PDH, ATM, or gigabit Ethernet supporting. So how it is supporting gigabit Ethernet technology, that you can explain in detail with the help of this diagram. Then you are going to make this OTN an ideal optical network by explaining how it is supporting the IP along with these functionalities. Okay. Then later you can explain about its economics. That one part is over. Second part will be it's a two applications you have to focus here. One is how it is going to provide you the end-to-end path protection by using more number of TCMs. TCM means tandem connection monitoring, as SDH is supporting only one. Okay, so this one function, and along with this OTN switching, how it is supporting the optical switching with the help of the OADMs in the SDH layer. So this flow you have to draw, and with this figure you have to explain the optical switching using this OTN. And this one, the actual layered structure of this OTN, you have to tell after the definition and brief explanation. Okay, then these applications will be coming at the end. So this all about OTN, that you can remember and write the answers with this flow. Next one we are going to discuss it today is Internet Protocol, which is actually meant for the allowing the transmission of packets, routing of packets in the network layer. So it is possible because it contains both addressing and control information that allows the IP to route the packets in the network layer. Its logical architecture has been shown here, which is actually the independent of any particular network, and it is allowing each network node to communicate with each other without knowing which network it's using and how to route information between them. So IP can also support signaling and routing, like MPLS and GMPLS. We are going to discuss at the end of this module. So this technology. IP is also going to support the reliable data transmission, the packet transmission, with the help of the TCP protocol. As compared to the reliability is more with the TCP as compared with UDP. So that's why they are using TCP IP rather than UDP IP, as it has been shown in this diagram. So there are three generic stages are there as far as the deployment of this IP networks are concerned. So in the first generation, you can see this figure is going to tell you the generic stages, how this IP networks are deployed. In three different categories, it has been deployed. So as IP is also supported or coming under this OTN, so this also having the support of SDH and WDM technologies. Depending on the requirement, it may use SONET WDM together or DWDM only without SONET. So first generation, it's actually meant for ATM. Suppose if you want this IP to be implemented only by using ATM, then ATM is already suffering from this overhead. If you want to transmit more data, then it is going to exceed the buffer of this ATM, asynchronous transport mode frame structure. So hence it is not so efficient as compared with the direct SDH or SONET. So therefore, the reasons have been quoted. Overhead requirements of the ATM cell structure are there. So internet overlap of IP packets will take place, which maps outside the ATM cell size. So therefore, to cope up with this, so the IP packets will be transmitted by mapping the IP packets directly onto the SDH frames, which is known as actually packet over SONET, also known as POS. So this mapping can be done in three different steps. First, the data is segmented into IP packets. So this I am explaining, that is the first generation, that is the first column, which is including the four different blocks: IP, ATM, SONET, and WDM. So here, to cope up with the overhead problem of ATM, so IP is also going to depend on the SONET and WDM. So now it is using SONET, where the IP packets will be directly mapped onto the SDH frames by the steps are like this. The data segmentation is data is segmented into IP packets, then it will be encapsulated through the PPP, that is a point to point protocol. Then framing information is added in this second stage, and in the final stage, the resultant data is mapped synchronously onto the SDH frame. So depending on the requirement, in the second stage, IP may use only a SONET or DWDM. So where thin layer of SONET will be used along with the DWDM. Because the SDH is not bandwidth efficient, because it uses synchronous TDM, where time allocation is static. So that is a problem with the SDH. In that case, they will go for the a thin SONET. IP will be used along with the thin SONET and DWDM. So the third stage includes IP over DWDM only without any SONET. So that is going to increase its sophistication of the optical and photonic enabling technologies. So here, a more optoelectronic conversions will take place. So these are the three different generic stages of deployment of the IP networks. So if you get a question like a discuss or a short note on this IP, you begin with this short description, the background of this IP with this logical architecture, and then you can conclude with this three generic stages of the deployment. So the next we'll continue the discussion, how actually the implementation will take place, that is IP over DWDM. So we are continuing with this third generic stage, where IP will be deployed over DWDM. So there are three different possibilities or techniques are there for your syllabus. So one is wavelength routing networks, second optical switching networks, and the third one is optical network deployment. So each one will be separately discussed in detail. So under wavelength routing networks, it is mainly concerned with the establishment of the physical and light paths between the different nodes of the optical network. How can begin with this wavelength routing networks? It is mainly concerned with the establishment of the physical and light paths. Okay, we know the physical path means which are permanently connected. Light paths means virtually. Semi-permanently they are connected, or they will be got connected as per the requirement. So for example, we'll take an example of an optical network consisting of three nodes here, node 1, node 2 and node 3. Here you can see the dashed line or thick line, it will indicate the physical connection or physical path. Node 1 and 2 are connected by the lambda 1, wavelength lambda 1. 2 and 3 are connected by lambda 2. Suppose if it is required to connect node 1, 2, 3 with the help of lambda 1, that light path or physical path will not exist between 2 and 3. If it will exist between 2 and 3, we need to provide some light path between 2 and 3, or we have to do the wavelength conversion, because node 1 and 2 got connected by lambda 2 light path. So we can convert this lambda 2 to lambda 1 so that 2 and 3 got connected. Like that we can be able to connect node 1 and 3 with help of lambda 1. But right now it is not possible in the figure A. So this problem where the light path cannot be established on a link using a single wavelength channel, is this problem is known as wavelength continuity constraint, WCC. So this can be resolved by using wavelength convertible node. Means node 2 will be configured to act like a convertible node, wavelength conversion. It can do the wavelength conversion, that is from lambda 2 to compatible lambda 1, that is coming out from the output port of node 2. So the networks which uses such wavelength conversion nodes or devices or switches are actually known as wavelength convertible networks, WCNs. Okay. So this is about the concept of this wavelength routing networks. So what is the key point here? So figure A, it is suffering from the problem of wavelength continuity constraint, and this can be resolved by using wavelength convertible node. And such networks which are employing such wavelength convertible switches or nodes are known as wavelength convertible networks. Again, there are three different types are there, wavelength convertible routing network architectures. Three network architectures are there, as it has been shown in this diagram. The first one is full or rededicated wavelength converters. Fully dedicated or rededicated wavelength converters. In this figure, you can see just a little bit enlarged. Optical switch is there. On the right hand side, you can see WC boxes are there. Each WC will indicate wavelength converter. Means each path having its own dedicated wavelength converter. At the top you can see the top WC box is converting lambda 1 to lambda 2. Like that, each WC is dedicated for conversion of a particular input wavelength to the compatible output wavelength. That's what is known as a fully or rededicated wavelength converters. and these wavelength converters are not applicable for the wavelengths which are involved in the add-drop operation. You can see here, locally added optical signal, locally dropped optical signal. These signals are coming and going through this optical switch with the to and fro by the OADMs in the SDH layer, where OADMs are interconnected and they are doing this operation. Optically, they are adding and dropping the desired wavelength signals. Apart from this, these WCs are dedicatedly available to convert particular wavelengths. But using these dedicated WCs, as their numbers increases, the compatibility and cost will matter. To resolve this issue, the cost and compatibility matter, we'll go for combining the WCs and started using wavelength convertible banks, as you can see in this one. So that is known as sparse wavelength convertible network architectures. This one, this figure is that is fully dedicated wavelength converters, where for each path you are using one WC converter that is coming under wavelength convertible network. So to resolve the costly effect, costlier scenario of this using WC for each path, we'll go for combining the WCs in the form of WC banks. So hence it is known as sparse wavelength convertible network architectures. In that, again, we are going to have two subtypes where the wavelength will be shared per link. As you can see in this figure, two wavelengths, input wavelengths, lambda 1 or lambda 2. Lambda 1 is directly connected. Lambda 2, the particular wavelength that we want it to be converted to lambda 3. That got converted along with another wavelength that we don't know. Okay. Compared to previous figure, in this figure, what is the difference is that here multiple wavelengths got converted. In the previous figure, only one wavelength will be got converted. And for each such conversion, one WC box will be used. That will be replaced by using this bank. Here you can see, the WCB has been shown in an enlarged figure. That is nothing but it is involves the set of WCs. Okay, this is shared per link. So particular desired wavelengths got converted at a time. That is known as shared per link. So another one will get shared per node. Means any desired input particular wavelength, lambda 2 here, for example, coming from the input, got converted to lambda 3 with the help of WCB. Okay, then it will be routed to the particular dedicated path or particular node. That's what is known as shared per node. So previous one is a shared per link, where the output of the converted wavelength from the output of WCB, it is not worrying about it, it's routing to the particular node. Just a shared per link. Here it is worrying, that is known as shared per node. That is the only difference. So this about the wavelength convertible network architectures. So don't confuse here. We are discussing wavelength routing networks under the implementation of IP over DWDM. Under this wavelength routing networks, we discussed about wavelength continuity constraint and wavelength convertible networks with help of this figure. Then we continued our discussion with this wavelength convertible networks as architectures. One is dedicated wavelength converters it is using. Another one, it got replaced with the WCB, wavelength convertible banks. So two types are coming under this one, sparse wavelength convertible network architectures. One is shared per link, another one is shared per node. So this is all about wavelength routing networks. that is coming under IP over TWDM implementation. Next, we have to discuss about optical switching networks. That we can take separately at the end. But before that, still I have to discuss some other important concepts with respect to wavelength routing networks. So this concept already we have studied, that is RWA, that is routing and wavelength assignment. Okay, this is the heading is that implementation of IP over DWDM is that. Under that, wavelength routing network architectures we have studied. And as we are discussing this as implementation of IP over DWDM, DWDM has got the drawback. That is, we are discussing under this RWA concept. Because in the issue with the DWDM is that in DWDM, a light path is established by reserving particular wavelength and physical links between two nodes or source and destination, we can tell. So that reservation is an issue here. It is a two-stage search and select process related to both routing and wavelength assignment. So they fall into two basic types here to resolve this problem. The two ways are there. Either you can implement this sequential or combinational selections. So to implement this issue, resolve this issue of the DWDM, we have to reserve the particular wavelength. Light path has to be reserved for the particular wavelength to establish the physical link between the nodes. That can be resolved by in two different ways, static and dynamic. In a static RWA technique, semi-permanent connections, it depends on the semi-permanent connection, where it remains active for some time and it will be operated based on the traffic patterns. And this pattern will be predicted or will be known in advance. Whereas in dynamic RWA technique deals with the establishing the light path frequently based on the dynamically varying traffic patterns. Means traffic, how much amount of traffic we are getting is not known in advance. So this way the issue with DWDM can be resolved with the help of this either static or dynamic RWP techniques. That is routing. Further, we can explain this with the help of this an optical network consisting of five nodes here. Suppose if you want to transmit a packet from node 1 to node 5. So with this figure, what we are going to explain here, along with the extension of this RWA concept, how it is going to resolve the DWDM issue, we have seen. Further, what other things it is going to do, that we can understand with the help of this figure. The thick line, it has been shown, it is a physical connection or a fixed connection. Circle will indicate the network nodes. And dotted lines, they will indicate the light path or virtual paths. So RWA will also help us in selecting such paths having reduced number of hops. For example, hops means you can better understand. Let me complete the explanation. Suppose if you want to transmit the packet from node 1 to node 5, there are different possibilities of the paths which will exist between node 1 to node 5. Either you can transverse via node 2, that is known as single hop, means only one node you are coming across. Or you can transverse through node 4 and 2. It is like this, 4, 2, and 5. Means it is a two hops. Means two nodes are you are coming across in order to establish the light path between node 1 to 5. Another two hop light path will be through 2 and 3. It is like this, 1, 2, 3, 5. Through hops, it is 4, 2, and 3. It is like this, 1, 4, 2, 3, and 5. It is a very long multiple hop network path. So RWE will also help us to select the path having less number of hops. Okay, so that's why this figure you have to create to explain another advantage. But sometimes the condition will arise where in an optical network, nodes are more with compared to the available wavelength channels. If the available wavelength channels are less in number compared to the nodes, then the condition will arise, situation will arise where the network link will becomes unavailable between the two nodes to be connected. Such situation or condition is known as a blocking of the channel. So the probability of such blocking of channel increases in such scenario where the number of nodes will be more compared to the available wavelength channels. So that probability can also be assessed by this RWE. So RWE plays a very important role in deciding the blocking probability of network. It also provides information about availability of path or link between the any two desired nodes. So to measure, you can say, the functions of RWE like that you can tell. It is going to, RWE will help us to solve the issue of DWDM, that DWDM is required to reserve the light path for a particular wavelength on a physical connection to be made with the help of static and dynamic RWE techniques. Second one, it helps to decide the light path to be established with minimum number of hops. That is going to be going to reduce the cost and the power consumption. Third point, it plays important role in the deciding the blocking probability of the network. Along with it also provides what is the shortest path with the reduced number of hops. That's just I told. Okay. Then what is the routing concept here? This is the routing concept. What is the wavelength assignment concept? So that we can explain with the help of this graph coloring, you can tell. Wavelength assignment means here you can take an example of the optical network in the ring topology where four nodes are connected in the ring fashion. The thick line will indicate the path that will be connecting all the four nodes. Like it has been shown here, from the transmitter to the receiver, it is transverse with the three nodes, three hops will be there. Similarly, the lambda 3 is the light path which is connecting between DTX to B. DTX is here to B. This one particular separate line path will be transverse, DTX to B, that is lambda 4. Another one is going from B to DRX. B to DRX, this one inside internal is there, this one. That is indicated by the lambda 5 path. Similarly, the light path which is connecting 4 and 5 nodes, where it is, or you can say the light path which is connecting 4 means it is A, 5 means it is connecting C. A and C, where are they are connected? This one, the outer skirt line is there, no? That one. That is indicated by lambda 3. That is connecting these two, lambda 4 and lambda 5. Similarly, lambda 1, that is the light path 1, that is connecting between DTX and DA. DTX and DA is here, the thick line. That is indicating the light path corresponding to lambda 1. Similarly, C and DRX, C and DRX is all the way where it is coming, C to DRX, this thick line, C to B, B to A, A to DRX, like this, that is indicated by this light path, lambda 1 or light path 2. So means that this actually, if you draw it with these different light paths with the different wavelengths, that will be giving you the graph coloring, having different patterns. means with this different graph coloring RWA helps to decide the length of the path in terms of the number of hops. You can see here, you can easily assess how many intermediate nodes you are getting when you are going to traverse from one node to another node, thereby helping us to decide which shortest path we have to consider for the virtual connection to be established with the minimum number of hops. That is possible with the help of the graph coloring, that we can actually get it by the RWA. Okay, so this is how the wavelength assignment could be done with the help of the graph coloring. So guys, this is all about routing and wavelength assignment. Normally, we'll get a short note and discussion on this one. Initially, we can elaborate the routing concept, that is how the RWA is going to help solve the issues with the DWDM with the help of static and dynamic RWA techniques. And later, you can also extend its telling about its other major advantage of RWA, that it helps us to decide or to assess the blocking probability of a network in the scenario where the number of nodes are more in number compared to the available wavelength channels. It also provides you the path with the reduced number of hops. Wavelength assignment concept, we can explain with the help of this figure. And it will here, RWA will help us to provide you the path with a different number of hops and helping us to decide the shortest path with the reduced number of hops with the help of the graph coloring. Okay. So this is all about the wavelength routing network architectures and RWA concept. So next one here, guys, actually we'll wind up our this discussion. That is a wavelength routing networks discussion is over. That is the implementation of IP over DWDM. So in the next session, we are going to discuss about optical switching networks. Optical switching networks actually consist of four different types. Optical circuit switching networks, packet switching networks, MPLS, that just I told, MPLS somewhere here is coming. So these MPLS, they were, we have discussed in the initially, today's in the beginning of the IP discussion, MPLS. So that we are getting here, MPLS, and last one, optical burst switching networks. So these things, that is a second aspect, that is how the IP can be implemented over DWDM, that we are going to discuss under the second heading, that is optical switching networks, we'll be going to see in the next session. Today we have discussed implementation of IP over DWDM under the heading of wavelength routing networks, that is over. Tomorrow we are going to, in the next session, we are going to discuss again the same, the implementation of IP over DWDM with the help of OSN, that is optical switching networks. Okay, let's stop today's discussion.